Amen, amen. Good morning and greetings, Hanover Saints. It is always a joy to be with you here in worship, those who are here in person, those who may tune in a little bit later. For all the ways that God promises to meet us, we are grateful. Let us turn our attention to our call to worship, which is what I like to call our invitation from arriving here to really being here together. In the image of God, you created everything and called it good. We reject all messages that belittle or degrade any among us. And so in faithfulness to God and one another, we proclaim, praise God, our Creator, who blesses us with this world, these bodies, and our fellow creatures, all created good and very good. Amen. Amen. Amen to God. Well, I don't know about you, but when I come to church, part of that is seeking the peace of God, which is promised to us when we confess together our sins and also know that the assurance comes down on us. Knowing that that peace of Christ comes to us, we are called to share that peace with one another. So let us do so today. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Let us pray together. God, who hears the joys and concerns that were lifted today, as well as the prayers that remain on our hearts, we are grateful. Christ, who gives us direction for renewing our discipleship, your word enables us to enter more deeply into the Christian life. You call us not just to refrain from violence, but even from those hurtful and unkind words and thoughts that sometimes linger. You call us to ponder deep flourishing for all your people and for your entire creation. Empower us to live by your way in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy One, help us to embody the peace that we shared with one another today. By doing so, may we be your peace in the world. We know too well our divisions based in gender, race, sexuality, class, but help us bear witness to a different reality. Help us begin the process of healing and deliverance. Help us form new ways of being in mutuality, love, and justice with and through one another. Empower us to live out of your love in all that we do, healing divisions, addressing enmity, reaching out to those that we perceive as other. God of all nations, we pray for this nation as well as all countries around the globe. For those charged to exercise leadership on behalf of the common good, help them to discern wise uses of resources, addressing the needs of the vulnerable. For those suffering from wars and economic strain and oppression, move us all to attend to the cries of those in our midst. For all those things that have been lifted today, those things that continue to weigh on us, we pray all these things in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Divine Creator, we come before you with humble hearts, acknowledging our shortcomings and seeking forgiveness. We confess, O God, that we have subjected others to the kind of rejection and misunderstanding that you yourself experienced in the form of Jesus. We try to control the paths of those we love, deeming them out of their minds or unworthy of acceptance when they veer from our expectations. Have mercy on us, O God, when we have believed what others say about us rather than what you have. Have mercy on us, O God, when we have caused others to doubt your love. Forgive us for the moments we stand in our own way or in the way of others, dimming a God-given light, participating in the silence of God-given voices. Help us, O God, to live all and be as Forgive us, O God, for the times when we have allowed ego to overshine our ability to extend solidarity and support to our most marginalized siblings. Give us courage to trust our belovedness, even in a world that sometimes threatens to snuff out the life that has been breathed into us by God. Amen. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The scripture today is from Mark, Mark 3rd, verses 22 through 30. And the crowd came together again so that they could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, "He has gone out of his mind." And in the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, "He has Beelzebub, and by the rulers of the demons he casts out demons." And he called them to him and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand. But his end had come, and no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly, I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter, but whoever blasphemies against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. And for that, they have said, "He has an unclean spirit."
Amen. Well, I did the pastoral prayer a little early. But I just, I felt like I needed to pray. So we are grateful for the ways that the Spirit just does what she wants. And so the message this morning: an undivided house, Jesus' revolutionary path. Friends, last month when I was here, I had the opportunity, the wonderful opportunity, to preach for our Pride Month celebration, speaking about the celebration of diversity, and emphasizing that God didn't make any mistakes in creating any of us, that there are things about us that are inherent to our nature that glorify God. Also underscoring the importance of accepting ourselves and those who are different. And then afterwards, I stayed to give a talk on this church and its discernment for inclusion and welcoming those who are different and joining organizations like More Light, Presbyterians, that teach us how to widen our welcome and making it clear that all of God's people are sacred. Many of you were there and we had great conversation and great fellowship together. I will say not everyone was pleased by this display of acceptance. As the event ended, I had a conversation with someone who was visibly upset and introduced themselves and then launched into a discussion about why they disagreed and quoted scriptures, the 6-7 scriptures condemning homosexuality. And every now and then I attempted to interject, but it quickly became apparent that this was not going to be a conversation. This person had their mind made up. So I listened, and this person began using very violent, very offensive terminology. And so I said, if we're going to talk that way, I will not continue this conversation. Well, of course, this doesn't necessarily stop people. It makes them even angrier. And so after a while, the conversation ended with some loose ends, some hurt feelings. And I have to admit that I had a human reaction to the conversation. I went home, I became sick, I struggled, and I thought about the conversation for a couple days until I was able to find some peace. And as I reflected, a phrase from that conversation kept coming up for me again and again, that I was a part of the devil's agenda. It's a phrase that I have heard more than once in my life and ministry. This is the devil's agenda. Perhaps you have heard it too, that the particular ways that you live out your faith or particular ways that you welcome and embrace are part of the devil's agenda, especially when it doesn't align with others' expectations. Now, this is really not about this person. This is not about shame. But the whole experience brought me back to a piece that I wrote a while back on Mark chapter 3, our passage today, for a series on Unbound, which you can Google if you'd like to read more. Some of what I will talk about comes from that piece directly, and some of it involves new insights that have arisen from this conversation, as well as our moment in history today. Amen. As I went home last month after this incident, I began to think about Mark's Jesus. Mark's Jesus that is presented to us in chapter 3, we see Jesus's intentions and mission being dismissed in profound and even disturbing ways. We don't know much about Jesus's childhood, but perhaps he initially, as a child, went along to get along, at least for a little while. We have that one story of him in the temple. But as he grows up and his calling becomes clearer, that begins to change. As Jesus grows up and he comes into his own, he becomes like this strange creature to those around him. He begins to be targeted by religious officials and government officials. In verse 21, even his own family is ready to restrain him because they say he's out of his mind. And so Jesus, as he grows, he begins flipping roles and perverting the status quo, unraveling at the seams. And people say, what happened to the son of Joseph? What happened? He's disregarding all of the expectations that his family, his religion, his culture had set for him. And so in Mark, he is presented as a particular kind of Messiah, a healer, a seer, a revolutionary who comes to upend expectation. His very body, his presence, forces uprisings and conversations, forcing those to encounter him to unlearn some things, rethink some things. Everyone around him has a very strong reaction, loving him, hating him, not really sure what to do with him. But violence, especially spiritual and emotional violence, always seem to cross his path. The people's disdain for Jesus is so profound that they begin to criticize and undermine his authority. Like, they observe Jesus' justice work, which only causes them confusion and outrage. They are watching demons literally leap out of people as they are cast out of people and communities and systems. They watch Jesus just bulldoze through death-dealing norms and leading people to freedom. I mean, imagine it. Maybe when people encountered Jesus, they began that process of self-acceptance, that process of shedding others' expectations. That is his power when people meet him. And so no one can deny that Jesus has some kind of power running through his veins, but the religious leaders begin to explain it only by saying that his power is corrupt, because he does not behave as expected. They condemn him with the most horrendous accusation they can think of. They accuse him of having demons, being an accomplice to Satan. They accuse him of being a part of the devil's agenda. The people's violence is so profound. And while Jesus does not say much in response, he does give us a parable, as he always does, because he's so confusing. But he does call them out for a type of inconsistency. He says, how could Satan drive out Satan? And how could a house that is divided against itself still stand? In other words, I call you to see this as, how could evil lead to liberation? How could demons bring someone to wholeness? How could demons bring people to acceptance of themselves and others? In Matthew 7, Jesus teaches that we should test a tree by the fruit that it bears. In other words, the effects that something has will tell us profound things about the essence of that thing. And so in this passage, the evidence of good fruit is all around Jesus, even as accusations are swirling all around. People who encounter this miracle-working Jesus experience healing and confidence, and their backs start to straighten up, and they experience liberation in their bodies, in their minds, and in their spirits. When people encounter him, they begin living as their true selves. They begin loving who they want to love and living without fear. They start feeling at home in themselves and free in themselves. That is the fruit that follows Jesus. When Mark's Jesus walks into a space preaching the goodness and power of God, the demons begin leaping out of people because they no longer have control, and Satan gets nervous because his desire for people to hate themselves and one another begins to melt away. That is the fruit of Jesus' ministry. So Jesus asks his accusers, how could this be? How How could Satan drive out Satan? Look at the fruit of my life. How could a house that is divided against itself still stand? How could Satan heal people? How could Satan talk people down from suicide? How could Satan increase love and bring people closer to God? How many among us today have been accused of evil when we did not live up to people's expectations? How many among us have been demonized, bending the arc towards justice? In a world where people's stories are being banned, and folks are being accused of having a family killing, a culture killing agenda, I relate to Mark's Jesus. And I think about revolutionaries killed because they dared to point people towards a better world. I think about people all across the world who have lost their lives because they had the audacity to point to something different, to be their true selves, like Jesus. Their lives and actions bear good fruit even as they face persecution. And so as we listen to the story, we see this strange point where the people accusing Jesus put themselves in a dangerous position, where Jesus says that they have committed an unforgivable act. And scholars and ministers, we've long debated, what does it mean to blaspheme the Holy Spirit, to commit something that is unforgivable? Isn't that going against what God has proclaimed? And so we've wrestled with what this means. Some have claimed that this is as simple as thinking a bad thought or taking the Lord's name in vain, but others, like me, I would recognize something much deeper, a hardening of heart, an inability to recognize the movement of the Spirit, to call something that is good evil. We see it in the story itself. The people accusing Jesus, they are seeing these hints of progress, and they mock at it, and they scoff at it, and they are threatened by it, and they try to stop it, and they mistake this work of freedom for satanic evil. And not only do they oppose freedom, but they are afraid of free people. And so in the text, I'd argue that people committed to a certain worldview may never be able to live in the land of the living because they don't even recognize when they're there. Recognizing when you are in heaven and being able to call it heaven and calling it evil, that is what Jesus is talking about. It's not unforgivable because God doesn't want to. It is unforgivable because we could never see it for what it is. You are in heaven. Name it and recognize it. Celebrate it and claim it. Mark's Jesus teaches us that when we stand in the way of God's movement, wherever it may take place, we might put ourselves on evil's path because of a made-up mind. The scribes dismissed the hope of God's restoration, dismissed the movement of God in certain people. And so this is the type of thing that is an entirely made-up mind. It is a mind that cannot be changed or moved even when new information is provided. Such people have seen the work of God up close in Jesus and deny the power that is there. It is not just a misunderstanding or disagreement, is a turning away, a closing off of any possibility. And so this kind of thing manifests today when individuals or institutions see any type of progress and they react to it with opposition. It is that entirely made up mind that God can't cut through a lot of times. It occurs when people see the good fruit, the increased acts of love and healing, the justice work, and they respond by, "That's evil." Now, I believe all of us are capable of transformation, even as we are tempted each moment, each day, to choose the easier way out. But as people of faith, we must be vigilant, we must be reflective, ensuring that we do not give ourselves to a made-up mind. When we encounter new information or new kinds of expression or an interpretation that we never heard before, it's praying for humility, it's praying for a softness and openness, our hearts to the possibility that the Spirit might be at work in ways that we've not even considered. It's recognizing the good fruit when it's there. It's knowing when we are presented with heaven and celebrating it. And so, as a congregation aspiring to be inclusive, thinking about this incident and other incidents that may come up in the future, how can you prepare yourselves for opposition? Responding with the wisdom that is instructed in 1 Peter 3:15, which urges us to always be ready to give an answer for the hope that we have. To do so with gentleness and respect, but to always say that though opposition may come, though misunderstanding may come, how will you respond? When folks say, "This is the devil's agenda." This kind of preparation involves understanding that our advocacy can provoke resistance, often from those who misinterpret or fear what's happening. But by grounding ourselves in the teachings, maybe of Mark 3, we learn the importance of being steadfast and compassionate in the face of criticism. And moreover, how will you protect the vulnerable from such accusations? How will you protect those who are marginalized from taking the brunt of persecution? How will you step in on their behalf, creating a space where each and every person feels protected and valued? In doing so, I argue that we reflect the undivided house that Jesus envisioned, a revolutionary path where love and justice and inclusion stand firm against division and hatred. So, family of faith, let us challenge ourselves and those around us to see and even anticipate the good fruit in the lives of others, particularly those who have been demonized. And let us recognize the Spirit's work in the fight for justice, the push for inclusion, the celebration of diversity. In doing so, we participate in heaven, which is already among us and continues to grow through our actions of love. Amen. Amen. Friends, all the rules and laws of our faith can be summed up in the law of love for God and for one another. Everything hangs on that, the law of love. We don't just talk about love here at Hanover, we bring it to life in ministry. We offer hospitality, we build community, we act in compassion, we do justice work, and in all these things we worship and love God, and we offer love to our neighbor. That is what this ministry and our gifts are about, and all of it hangs on love. So let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. Amen. So we did our pastoral prayer, but I thought I might offer just a short prayer before our closing hymn. So let us join together. God of love, God of freedom, be with us today. Move in us as we seek and discern the ways to bring your message into the world. We pray that the promise of your forgiveness would be close to us, the promise of your assurance that we do not have to do any of the work you call us to do on our own. It is not up to any single person, but that we might see the work when we all come together with all of our gifts, whether it's writing, whether it's speaking, whether it's cooking, whether it's advocating, whether it's singing, whatever it is, that we might see your power when all of us are working together. We pray that you would give us the humility and openness to not only receive things that are new and different, but also that openness to understand what our role is in this work. That we wouldn't just invite in new ideas, but that we would also prepare ourselves for what may come, knowing that you have already gone with us and before us, alongside us, that there are saints and prophets who have walked this journey before us, who power us to do this good work. So Lord, remind us that we go in your strength. Soften our hearts, empower us, that we might stand strong and boldly in a way rooted in your love. In Christ's name, amen. came here seeking peace, I send you out with the peace of God, which promises to empower us in all of our work, inside, outside, with ourselves, with one another, and with the world. Go in peace, knowing that you are loved and called to extend that same love everywhere you go. Amen.